Morning to everybody. Good morning. I'm glad to be here. Glad to see you all here. What wonderful windows. Not sure if they were there last week, but love them. They look great. We're going to begin, as we often do, with some hymns that you likely will know. If you have a hymnal, it's hymn number 671. We're going to begin with America, and then America the Beautiful. So if you are ready, willing, and able, please stand and let's begin by singing. I had in my notes verses 1, 2, and 4, but we did 1, 2, and 3, which was splendid. We'll see what happens on the next one. America the Beautiful. We'll do 3 verses no matter what. You may be seated.
Good morning, everybody. Good to have everyone with us this morning. Thanks for being here. One quick thing for our live stream, folks. The internet is not cooperating this morning, so there's a really good chance that it's not going to make it through the service. So it may have already been cut out, and I'm just talking to a camera, and that's it. But if you are still there, you are hopefully, if it cuts out, check back later. We'll have the recording. We'll have it up so that you can see the full service if you want. But it's not us. It's the internet is it's the company that's having trouble this morning, which is rare. It's usually us, but today is not. All right, just a couple of other things real quick. Operation Christmas Child. So toys. Do we have all the sunglasses? Okay, children's sunglasses, and then looking for toys as well for children. What were the ages again? Sorry. 5 to 10, boys and girls. And, you know, remember they're going in a shoebox, so it can't be a big toy. And there are certain items that would not be appropriate, primarily like military and some different things like that. So if you have any kind of questions about that, be sure and ask us, and we'll get the answers for you. But like matchbox cars, you know, like different stuff like that would be perfect. We have the yard sale for the youth group coming up on July 9th. If you brought items today, then we'll get them into the basement after the service. If you wanted to bring stuff but you haven't yet, please talk to me today. And there's a very specific reason for that. The Simmons family is hitting the road early tomorrow morning. So I'm not going to be around for the week. So we got to get it all figured out and sorted today before we take off. So we're going to be traveling. If everything goes well, and as it should, we will be back on the 16th. So we should be able to be here for the 17th, that Sunday. If we're not here on the 17th, something's gone wrong, please pray for us. But hopefully it'll all be fine. We're traveling back to Ohio to see family. So we appreciate your prayers just for travel, the safeties, and so forth. And Nancy's got her hand up. Wednesday 1 to 4, Nancy will be here at the building if anybody wants to bring stuff. Live stream, if you're still there and you want to bring stuff, feel free to bring it. No huge furniture, please. that would kind of be that would make it difficult probably, but other stuff would be great. Last thing, we're doing communion today. So if you want to do that and you didn't grab the elements that are in the entryway, now if you have grabbed them and you looked at them, you can see they're different, right? Now I ordered a different set on purpose just to make you miserable. I did order a different style on purpose just for us to be able to see that there are different things out there. Because we are in a process of trying to figure out what are we going to do long term with this, all right? So please understand this. I'm not operating by what do we like or not like. That's not factoring into the decision process, okay? So when we get there, we'll walk through it. There is going to be a little different process to opening them up and so forth. We're going to be fine. We're going to be more than fine. We're going to be great, okay? Justin loves it. That's all I need is Justin's approval. All right. Okay. That's it before I get in trouble, or more trouble. So let me pray for us, and then we'll get going with the service. So join me in prayer, please. Heavenly Father, thank you for today. What a beautiful, beautiful day it is, and what a wonderful gift it is to be able to gather together as the church, as we are here gathered, Father. Focus us on you, and help us to, if we are distracted, help us to put the distractions to the side and to be able to listen to you, to be with you, to be open to what you have for us this morning. So may your will be done here today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I know Dennis has said that, but we'll just keep greeting you because we know that we're excited to be here. We're excited that you're here. Happy almost 4th, everybody, right? We're going to go before the Lord in song. If you would please stand with us, we are going to sing together. The King of love, my shepherd is, whose goodness faileth never. I nothing lack if I am his, and he is mine forever, and he is mine forever. Where streams of living water flow, thy ransomed soul he leadeth. And where the verdant pastures grow, with food celestial feedeth. Never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, lover of my soul. King of love, my shepherd is. The King of love, my shepherd is. Lost and foolish off I strayed, but yet in love he sought me, and on his shoulder gently lay, and home rejoicing brought me. In death's dark veil I fear no ill, with fear, dear Lord, beside me. Thy rod and staff my comfort still, thy cross before to guide me. Never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, nail and never. Good Shepherd, may I sing your praise within your house forever. Within your house forever. Amen. Thank you for singing with us. Our next song is very familiar, but just a little bit of a different beat, so we hope that you'll sing loud and proud with us on this one.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He hath loosed his fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. I have seen him in the watchfires of a hundred circling camps. They have builded him an altar in the evening dews and damps. I can read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His day is marching on. Glory, glory. With my condemners, so with you my grace shall deal. Let the hero born of woman crush the serpent with his heel. Since God is marching on, he has sounded forth the trumpet that shall never sound retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men for his judgment seat. Oh, be swift my soul to answer. Be jubilant at my feet. Our God is marching on. Glory, glory, to make man holy. Let us live to make man free. How God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Oh, glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory,
the God that we serve is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Amen? Yeah. Thank God for a truth that is real, that is easy to see, and that is unyielding. So in the name of Jesus, we will sing one more song, but let's pray before we go into that one. Heavenly Father, we just pray for spirits that are knowledgeable of who you are in your character, Lord, and knowing your truth, but Lord, also resting in the fact that you are the source of truth, just as you are the source of rest, you are the source of joy, you are the source of comfort. Lord, may we seek you, seek to know you, and therefore knowing your truth as truth. In the name of Jesus, we pray.
Foes are many, they rise against me, but I will hold my ground. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way, my help is on the way. Oh my God, He will not delay, my refuge and strength always. I will not fear, His promise is true, my God will come through always, always. Troubles surround me, chaos abounding, my soul will rest in you. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way, my help is on the way. Oh my God, refuge and strength always. I will not fear, His promise is true, my God will come through always, always.
Remember, this is where your help comes from.
I lift my eyes up, my help comes from the Lord. I lift my eyes up, my help comes from the Lord. I lift my eyes up, my help comes from the Lord.
For singing with us. You may be seated.
I wanted that one to keep going. That was great. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. That song, and it just speaks such a wonderful truth that just how wonderful our God is. He will not delay. He's taking care of us, and I'm so thankful. So thankful for God. I'm so thankful for this church. You are wonderful and generous people, and we do have so many troubles that are going on. But for us to be able to be together and to be the church together is a real beautiful gift. And so, thank you for everyone for all that you do. And let's keep going. Let's keep going together. Let's find out what God has for us in the future. Our scripture reading this morning is Psalm 56. Psalm 56. Be gracious to me, O God, for man tramples on me. All day long an attacker oppresses me. My enemies trample on me all day long, for many attack me proudly. When I am afraid, I put my trust in you. In God, whose word I praise, in God I trust, I shall not be afraid. What can flesh do to me? All day long they injure my cause. All their thoughts are against me for evil. They stir up strife. They lurk. They watch my steps as they have waited for my life. For their crime, will they escape? In wrath, cast down the peoples, O God. You have kept count of my tossings, put my tears in your bottle. Are they not in your book? Then my enemies will turn back in the day when I call. This I know, that God is for me. In God, whose word I praise, in the Lord, whose word I praise, in God I trust, I shall not be afraid. What can man do to me? I must perform my vows to you, O God. I will render thank offerings to you, for you have delivered my soul from death. Yes, my feet from falling, that I may walk before God in the light of life. Psalm 56. Last week we heard Psalm 37, and my hope is that if you do end up reading these two psalms together along with the Beatitudes that we're going through, you're going to see just all of this language coming together and making sense. And I really landed on 56 this week because of that third verse. When I am afraid, I put my trust in you. And that's going to tie in with where we're headed today. But as I was studying for this week, I found out I should have had Psalm 37 for this week, because there's a good likelihood that Jesus was thinking of Psalm 37 when he taught the Beatitude that we're going to look at today. So we're not going to read that one through today, but just wanted to remind us again. And if you can, spend time with these. With these psalms, they're beautiful and a real help to us. So, let's pray before we get into looking in Matthew 5 and the Beatitudes again. Pray with me, please. Heavenly Father, thank you for today again. Thank you for this church, for Gateway Alliance, you have blessed us. You are taking care of us. You are providing for us. I thank you for that, Father. We have unknown future ahead of us, but it is known to you. So help us when we are afraid to trust in you. Help us if we just can't put it together of what that next step is supposed to be. Help us to trust in you. Not only as a church, Father, we pray that for ourselves individually and our families as well. Just as we continue on with day after day of living in this amazing but troubled world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Alexander
the Great. Genghis Khan. Attila the Hun. The Egyptians. The Pharaohs. The Romans. The Caesars. The Greeks. Vikings. As according to modern television shows. The Mongols. The Barbarians. Lenin. Stalin. Stalinist terror. Hitler. The Nazi Holocaust. Pol Pot. Killing fields. Mao Zedong. The Maoist catastrophe. I'm going to stop there because those are the easiest ones. And if I go any further, I'll get into trouble. That list of names, that list of people groups. What is the fragrance of those names, of those people, of those events? Terror, Holocaust, killing fields, catastrophe. What fragrance exudes from these names? Jesus of Nazareth, the Christ. Not everyone in the world would agree, but as far as I'm concerned, there is a very different fragrance to the name of Jesus. I am biased, of course. Which fragrance are we, the Christian, supposed to have? There's a musician who sings a song called "I Love the Fragrance of Your Name." It's about the fragrance of the name of Jesus. A great temptation for us today is to cover over the fragrance of Jesus with the fragrance of the ways of the world. When we think about the great conquerors of the world, Alexander the Great, Genghis Khan, Attila the Hun, Egyptians, Pharaohs, Romans, Caesars, all that list that we mentioned, does a very specific type come to mind? That isn't Jesus. But no one ever has or ever will conquer like Jesus. Humanity says we will bless ourselves through power and violence. We will take what we want. Jesus says, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. The more you think about this statement, the more radical it becomes. The more you watch the world interact with each other, the more complicated this statement becomes. We're not going to have the time today to cover this beatitude appropriately. So we're going to have to leave a lot of things unsaid. To not say everything is not proclaiming there is no more. To not say everything is not proclaiming there is no more. So there's going to be a lot that we don't say today, but there is so much more. So much more that could be said about this beatitude and about the other ones that we have already looked at. But this one, especially in this time that we're living in, there's so many things that we could cover with just this one beatitude. So we're not saying everything, but in that we're not saying there isn't more to think through. There is a lot of complication with this beatitude also. So we're just going to try and cover a few things to get the wheels of the mind moving. And I'm going to be referencing, we're not going to really read them or anything like that. I'm going to reference them almost as like thought experiments for you to take with you, hopefully, and to just start thinking through some of these things. And then if you ever want to share it with me of where you end up, I would love to hear it. It's been a wild week for me thinking through all kinds of things with this beatitude, but it's gonna there's just so many interesting thoughts and thought experiments, philosophy type things that you can go in with this. So we're just trying to get the wheels of the mind moving today. I wanted to remind us of a few things about the Beatitudes. We've covered this before, but I'm covering it again and again and again in the hopes that it gets in us, so that later on, months from now, years from now, somebody says something about the Beatitudes, this stuff is in you, so that it's right there for a reference for you if you're having a conversation about the Beatitudes. So hear this again. So we're spending time with the Beatitudes. They're like these proverbial-type teachings from Jesus. And God is saying some very important things to us with these teachings. And they are so simple. And yet they're not at all. Right? Someone has said, the greatness of the Beatitudes is that they are not wistful glimpses of some future beauty. They are not even golden promises of some distant glory. They are triumphant shouts of bliss for a permanent joy that nothing in the world can take away. They also said the Beatitudes are congratulations on what is. Right? But also, we have to remember that they are not teachings on how to be blessed. The Beatitudes simply cannot be good news if they are understood as a set of how-tos for achieving blessedness. They would then only amount to a new legalism. And this is incredibly important for us to hold on to when we're with the Beatitudes. That author continued to say, the Beatitudes summarize the blessedness of life under God's rule, foundational for the spirituality of the messianic community. They assume a shared life within the community of God's reign rather than heroic efforts to live them out as solitary individuals. All of them taken together describe a fully integrated spirituality that characterizes life under the reign of God. Right? So we're not really supposed to take these individually, and it's just like the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit, you know, is like, all right, gentleness. Okay, I'll be good with that one. Self-control, no way. You know, I can't have self-control. No, they're a package deal, right? The Beatitudes are a package deal. The same way that we, as the church, we're a collection of people, and yes, we have individual lives and so forth, but we can't just be individualistic either, in a sense. We have to be together. So we want to be careful about looking at them as a whole package. Even though we're looking at one per week, we need to understand that they go together and they're supposed to stay together, right? So we also want to remember that the crowd that Jesus is teaching this to first is not the elite of the day. This is not an elite special group that he's pulled off to the side to this. This is not like VIP behind the velvet rope kind of thing. All right. He starts with those that the world would look at and say, why are you here? That's who he's starting with. Right. And that opens it up then for everybody. Jesus is saying all are welcome in the kingdom. All can be here. This is how. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. We can't get away from repentance. We have to understand repentance. We have to understand the condition of that we are in sin and so forth. And so repent. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The world operates differently. It's like, well, we have this, this, and this. That means we're this status and so forth. So we're up here, you are down there. You can never get up here, and it becomes all kinds of messy and so forth. Jesus doesn't play by those rules. With this beatitude, I was thinking about this, that I imagine that there could be some in the crowd that day that could have been thinking, well, Abraham, Joseph, Moses, Aaron, Joshua, David, Solomon, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Daniel, and others, and on and on and on and on. Certainly the Messiah would be thinking about them with inheritance. Do I fit? Can I receive an inheritance? I'm nobody compared to Abraham, compared to Moses. Yet Jesus is telling this crowd, you belong here. Repent. You're in. I find it to be good news that Jesus is so very different. John 14, he says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Right? I think Jesus is just saying it right out. I'm different from the world. I operate differently. You can't expect the way the world works. That's how I'm going to work. He said, I give to you differently from how the world does it. Hopefully we can see that and kind of put that puzzle together. That he doesn't give to us like the world. He doesn't follow the standards of the world. He's not concerned about his reputation in the world. Right? And speaking with this crowd that he starts with, would have given him a reputation that some people would have said, why are you talking to them? Why are you telling them this? Right? But he did. And he's talking to us, which is amazing. This is who Jesus is, and it's really good news for us. We're going to hear the Beatitudes again. I'm going to read them all for us again in Matthew chapter 5. As I read them, I want you to kind of, I'm going to use the word blessed, but I want you to think of, when you hear blessed, think of something that I came across in a translation that I was looking at this week. The person that put it together, instead of blessed, put spiritually prosperous. Spiritually prosperous. And I really like that. And so as I'm reading it for us and we're hearing blessed, I want us to think blessed as spiritually prosperous. All right? Matthew 5, verse 1. Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain. And when he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. He goes on, of course, with the rest of the Sermon on the Mount, but we're just going to stick with the Beatitudes here. So spiritually prosperous are those who are meek, because they themselves shall inherit the earth. Another author that I was reading through put together a whole bunch of things, and this was kind of combining a bunch of stuff. This was his take for this Beatitude. Oh, the bliss of the one who is always angry at the right time and never angry at the wrong time, who has every instinct and impulse and passion under control because they are God-controlled, who has the humility to realize their own ignorance and weakness. For such a person is a king among men. Somebody else put it together this way. You're blessed when you're content with just who you are, no more, no less. That's the moment you find yourself proud owners of everything that can't be bought. We have a lot of complication, as I said, with this beatitude because of how we understand the word meek in our day and age. Not always, but more times than not, in our Western civilization, meekness is thought of as a very bad thing. It wouldn't be a compliment in our modern times. You call someone meek, they're going to give you the side eye as they step back, right? And they're going to, I'll show you meek, right? It's going to get people pretty worked up. It's going to be seen as this negative thing. We seem to think of meekness as shyness, which labeled as shy is a very negative thing in our day and age. Meekness is quietness, and oftentimes being quiet is seen as a negative thing. Meekness is seen as weakness or dependent or fearful, on and on and on. There could be all kinds of different things that we think of as meekness. But that is not the idea that Jesus had when he is teaching. All right? One of the difficulties that we have is that words change meaning over long periods of time. Sometimes short periods of time, you know. Sometimes it's weeks now. But over long periods of time, words change in how they are used and how they are understood, different cultures and all this kind of stuff. So Jesus had a different understanding. The culture, the broader culture, had a different understanding of meekness at this time. And so that's what we have to try to tap into and try to understand. So at that time, some of the understanding for meekness was restraint under fire. Restraint under fire. Making the choice to cause no harm when under threat or attack. Right? Making the choice to cause no harm when under threat or attack. A picture that we can have is of a farm animal being domesticated, right? An animal which has learned to accept control. Very powerful animals, capable of great destruction, but that power is now being used for the betterment of life. That's the idea, right? So you think of an ox or even some of these horses on farms and so forth. These animals could put a hurting on you very quickly, right? But they are restrained. They are under control. They have a meekness to them. And so now, instead of reacting out of this wildness and attacking and all this kind of stuff, they are being part of the process of the farm work, raising the food and all of that kind of stuff. So it's about life and a betterment of life, right? So meekness as a Christ follower is not letting others do whatever they want. That's not the idea here. So meekness as a Christ follower is not letting others do whatever they want. We respond to injustice. We defend those who can't defend themselves. We speak up when it is needed. The difference is that we don't take things into our own hands. We don't respond as the world responds. Right? And to really get this, to really understand this, we have to study the life of Jesus because he lived this out. Right? You think of, we've talked about this before, you've read it before, you know, Jesus was mocked while he was dying on the cross. Come down, save yourself, all this kind of stuff, right? The meekness of Jesus meant that he didn't come off of that cross and show humanity what he was really capable of. He stayed there. He stayed on the cross. God could do all kinds of things to us. Goodness grace, mercy, kindness, meekness, restraint when under threat. I got a little bit of a picture of this as well, you know, if you want another animal to kind of think of. The other night I was outside of the house and we had a porcupine run through the yard. Right? Been here 11 years. It's only the second porcupine I've seen. The other one was, I was driving down the road, you know, so I'm, you know, oh, how cool is that? Well, I got to pay attention. This time, got to hang out with the little guy for a while, right? A porcupine, the North American porcupine, is meek. They're not aggressive. Thank you, Lord. A porcupine is capable of what? Causing you some serious pain, right? You mess around with them too much, you'll get the quill. But they're not aggressive, right? Imagine a porcupine, like a golden retriever, or a, you know, with that kind of energy, or like a pit bull, you know, and just they see you, they're coming after you, right? Okay, they're meek, they're restrained, they're capable, but they have a meekness to them. Right, so it's not a perfect illustration, but it's something to think about. So study the life of Jesus and see how he was meek. While he was, you read through the Gospels, you'll see this. You'll see him live out this beatitude. Right. Somebody has said that meekness is the capacity to stubbornly resist evil without doing violence to the evildoer. This kind of meekness is rooted solidly on our hope and confidence in God. Does the psalm start to come alive with this? Do the songs that we sang today start to come alive with this? Meekness is the capacity to stubbornly resist evil without doing violence to the evildoer. It's rooted solidly on our hope and confidence in God. So when we start to think about it in these ways, meekness, instead of being a bad thing, it starts to look actually quite incredible. It's an incredible thing, right? I've mentioned been mentioning some songs, and each week kind of there's been a song that's helped me as I've been thinking through this beatitude. The one for this week is "It Is Well With My Soul." And there's a version by Christine DeMarco that I really like that really goes with this. How can we not attack? It is well with our soul. We don't have to attack. Why? It is well with our soul. If we are with Jesus, it is well with our soul. We don't have to take things into our own hands. We don't have to attack. We don't have to go after people. We don't have to defend ourselves, our reputation out in the world. We can let some of those things go. Because it is well with our soul. For us to live this out, being meek in a world of rage, criticism, hatred, we have to know and believe that. It is well with our soul. And that will keep us from taking matters into our own hands. Some of you will remember, we are told that Moses was a man of meekness. Moses, this incredible leader, this incredible man, was a man of meekness. Here's the first thought experiment. Think on this with me. Swap Moses and Samson. And as you think on that, just think of the difference. Imagine Samson going into Egypt to lead Israel out. Imagine Samson leading the people in the wilderness. It's going to be a very different story. Right? It's going to be a drastically different story. But remember, Moses was on the pathway of becoming a Samson. He took matters into his own hands. He killed an Egyptian. But God took him into the wilderness and worked on him for a long time before he sent him into Egypt. Because Moses wasn't to go in out of control to conquer Egypt. Moses was sent in and going in saying, there is a God in the universe, and dearest Pharaoh, you are not him. There was conquering going on, but it was so vastly different. Samson took matters into his own hands. He wasn't self-controlled. That has to be developed by God. It's not how he lived. Moses wasn't perfect, of course. We know that. But he gives us the better example to live by. Too often today, I fear, we try to take the Samson path. Where will we end up if we do? Quickly, I want to focus on the second part of the Beatitude. The meek shall inherit the earth. And again, there's a lot being left unsaid here. But I find the word inherit, important here. Think of the difference between inheritance and conquering. It's a huge difference. How does one receive an inheritance? You can't buy it. You don't scratch a ticket or guess a number hoping you're lucky. You don't win it in a competition. It isn't something you take as the winner of a battle. You receive an inheritance. Receive it. In chapter 4 of Matthew, we read about the temptation of Jesus. Jesus was led into the wilderness to be tempted, and he went through 3 temptations. And if we're going to say that Jesus was fully human, then we have to know these were real temptations. This was not Jesus being like, oh, well, you know, whatever. That's not a big deal. No. This was significant. This was a real temptation, right? The third temptation by Satan to Jesus was for all the kingdoms of the earth. Take them. I'll give them to you. Take them, right? And Jesus thankfully said, no, I know this is a trap. He didn't give in. He knew that it wasn't an inheritance. It was this trap set by Satan. So there's another kind of thought experiment to work through of this inheriting the earth. There's one more example that I want to reference, and we're not going to read it, but just reference it. Familiar story. Luke 15, the prodigal son. You know the story. He goes to the father, give me what's mine. I'm going to take it now. He goes, he blows it. He ends up starving and working with the pigs. Right? And he's sitting there. The pigs are doing better than him. And he finally gets it. Right? And this process begins. I'm going to go back home. What do we see beginning to happen? And this is a parable. It's a story. It was a teaching by Jesus. But we kind of see this process of repentance that is taking place as he's returning back to the Father. He gets to the Father. He repents. And what happens? He receives. He receives. He's brought back in. He's brought back in to inherit. Right? Jesus ends the parable describing the younger brother like this. From the father was saying this to the older brother, but this was Jesus' teaching. This is how Jesus had the father talk about the younger son who repented and came back. He was dead and is now alive. He was lost and is now found. Blessed are the meek. They shall inherit the earth. It's a thought experiment. Think through. This beatitude slows us down. as soon as you think you got it, somebody is going to say something, and you're going to say, oh, I thought I had it. Now I got to think about all of these kind of things, right? You're going to say, okay, yep, I can see it. I want to do it. And then somebody's going to say something, or something's going to happen, and you're going to be ready to attack. You're like, oh, wait. It slows us down. Let's not be too quick to get away from it. Don't rush from it. Okay, yep. Meekness, I see it, yep. Different understanding now, it's a good thing then. So, all right, good, I got it, I'll move. Let's move on. We can't do that. Slow down with it, sit with it, think on this. Think of that Moses and Samson, prodigal son. Where else will God take you with this beatitude? What else is God going to teach us about this incredible statement? Blessed are the meek. They shall inherit the earth. So simple? Not quite, is it? It's really complicated. The more and more that you think about it, but Jesus taught it. And it's good and it's beautiful. In the spirit of this, we're going to move to communion. So if you have your little plastic chalice that you're all really excited about, go ahead and grab it. As I mentioned, it's a different style, so you want to have it juiced down to begin with so that we can get the wafer first. I have not tasted these. I have not tried them. I have no idea what they're like. But please remember, it's not the point. As we enter into this, I want us to think about receiving. I'm going on the fly here, not prepared. In a sense, you are receiving this little thing not by your choice, by the choice of another, me. Can you see it? I am with you in us receiving from Jesus at times things that we say no. In our humanness, we say, I don't like that. I wish that tasted better. I wish it tasted differently. I was really hoping that meekness would be more satisfactory to my humanness. Jesus, give. We receive. We, because of our time that we're living in, we can't really know what the crucifixion of Jesus looked like on that day. We can study it, so forth, but there's no way that we can enter into the just emotional shattering that took place for those watching Jesus die on the cross. There's no sense of anybody saying, I like that. That's beautiful. Because it wasn't. We can see it beautiful now because of what God has done through it. The cross, terrifying, terrible. Jesus did something different with it. He conquered. As we grab this little thing, we think about Jesus. grab the seal and start to open a tiny little wafer. And praise God that He gave for us to receive His body. This is my body. Take. He grabbed the cup. The disciples must have been wondering, what is he doing? You think they asked that question a lot? I think they probably did, right? What is he doing? They were with him for 3 years. So often, like he would say these things. So they'd just be like, did you get that? And they'll be, nope. I didn't get it. Jesus is preparing them for what's about to happen. They're still trying to deny it. He's saying, my blood is about to be shed all the way to death. This is going to be a picture for you to remember that. I'm going to give you something tangible to hold on to, remember. Because you're going to be tempted to forget. You're going to get busy. You're going to have things. There's going to be stuff you have to do. Don't forget. I shed my blood for you. Take and drink. Father, this is simple, and yet it's not. We have so many things that are going through our minds, so many things that are in our lives. We need help. We need help to be able to really focus on you, to see what you're teaching, to know how you are leading, where you're taking us. You've called us to live by faith, to walk by faith. That is so very difficult. You have put this together for us to receive, and not to take matters into our hands to conquer. So help us. Help us to be willing to follow after you in meekness, believing and knowing that that is how we inherit. Thank you for my friends here, Father. Bless them. Help them. Comfort them. We have struggles. We have fears. We have desires. We have successes. We have hopes. We have wonderful things. Through it all, Lord, help us to stay with you, praising you for being with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you all for being here. Would you stand with us for one more song?
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. is all my hope and peace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. All my praise for this I bring. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Parting scripture for this morning comes from Ephesians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Jesus Christ throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you for joining us this morning. Go in peace.